Good, how are you?
That's up behind you.
Journey, everyone. Would you stand with me as I read our call to worship? It's from Psalm 96. Psalmist says, "Oh, sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord all the earth. Sing unto the Lord, bless his name. Declare his salvation from day to day. Proclaim his glory among the nations, his wonders among all peoples. For the Lord is great, and greatly to be praised."
There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. There is freedom from the chains that bind us. Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside me. He roars like a lion, he bled as a lamb, he carries my healing in his hands. Jesus. There is a name all in times of trouble. There is a song that comforts in the night. There is a voice that calms the storm that rages. He is Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who
gathered here, a unique people in this place, in this time in history. Accomplish your purposes among us, O God. Tune our hearts to the voice of your Spirit, and tune our hearts to your Spirit in other people. And when we don't have words to say, let us use other words that other people give us, and let us lean on them, and let us lean on you through them. Prepare our hearts as we worship you today. Give us calm and grace when we need that. If we're lonely, may we find joy to enter into the grace of other people. And if we are joyful, let's share that with others. And thank you for meeting us here. Amen. Amen. So at this time, we welcome you, for one. So glad about that. Glad you're here. Glad you're watching with us. You're a part of our community, too, and we're just grateful that you're doing that, taking that time. The kids can go to Trek, I believe. The rest of you can say hi to the people around you as we keep moving.
Green light is blinking. Oh, okay. We're good. All right. They gave me the mic again. All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Gail. I don't know if we have any new people here. Maybe we do. I'm not sure. But for those of you who are worshiping with us today in person, you can see the Connect cards on the tables. So prayer requests and thanksgivings can be written on the back. And then if you're a guest and this is your first time filling out the card, we want to thank you by making a $5 donation to one of our partner organizations listed on the Connect card. So you can just check which organization you'd like to have receive this $5 in your name as like a welcome. And then you can drop your card in the boxes located in the back of the room. They're very fancy. But if you are online with us today, worshiping with us for the first time, we'd love to hear from you. So you can contact us via email at info@journeyoflongmont.org. I would also like to say, if you find any Nerf bullets in the lobby, we had a Nerf battle after Rap went to Lakeside. They could be anywhere because they were everywhere. So if you get one of those, you can have it make its way to Ted's classroom, I think is where we're storing the extra stuff. And I don't know, maybe they'll get paid in candy, who knows? Kind of like a bounty deal. But just a reminder, so immediately following our service today, we're gonna meet together at Left Hand Creek Park for a picnic. There's gonna be food. And that's all you need to know is that there's food so you can come. I found that that's a very driving factor. Our sincere appreciation and gratitude goes out to Brandy Turner and Kaylee Baker for their time and leadership as the cleaning coordinators and the nursery slash hospitality coordinator, respectively. You have blessed so many of our Journey families and visitors with your gifts and talents, and we want to thank you. So thank you to you guys. But we're now looking for people to step forward to fill these volunteer positions. So if you would like to, you can prayerfully consider if you're one of these people who can help us out. But in the meantime, we will have a sign-up sheet for various tasks around base camp, like nursery, coffee, and Sunday morning greeters. So if you have an interest in either filling one of these roles and or are available to assist with cleaning in the interim, contact Alicia Miller. And then we are also excited to announce that the Journey will be taking over the leadership of Trail Life Troop. So Trail Life's mission is to guide generations of courageous young men to honor God, lead with integrity, serve others, and experience outdoor adventure. Trail Life starts with kindergarten and goes all the way to high school. So you can check out the jottings for more information about this Trail Life troop, and then the other announcements as well are in the Journey jottings. My little brother is in it. I think AJ is in it, but it's like Boy Scouts, but a little to the left and better. I think we're not supposed to call it, compare them, but you know. For offering, we want to thank you for your continued giving. There are several ways you can give, many of which are listed on the screen behind me, or to the sides of me, because I'm up here, because I understand how the computers work now. They taught me things. Before I did it just because I was like, hey, they gave me the mic, I get to be the center of attention, now I'm doing it because it's better to not move the cameras. Where was I? Sorry. If you're here today in person, you also have the option of dropping your offering in the boxes next to the doors at the back of the room. And here at The Journey, we want to give back 10% of what God has blessed us with as a church family to one of our tithe recipients. This week, we highlight our tithe recipients to be Habitat for Humanity Apostles Build. So Apostles Build, if you didn't know, is a partnership that allows 12 individual churches to join together to build and fund a home for a local family. The work of Habitat for Humanity is driven by the desire to give tangible expression to the love of God through the work of eliminating substandard housing. I can read. I'm literate, I promise. And then we have prayer requests. So immediately following the message, there will be a time of reflection and silent prayer. Ongoing prayer requests will be posted on the slides. And then we have updated prayer requests this morning, being that Emily Kroonray, I should have asked, but I think it's that, sister of Chris and Joanne Ryrick's daughter-in-law and her newborn, they've returned home and they're getting stronger. So praise for that. And then Peter Raymer's mom accidentally found a new and very proactive orthopedic doctor while searching for a specialist to help her diminish her debilitating shoulder arm pains. She's begun a new therapy approach, so we want to pray for this to be successful. And then this week, the Journey is praying for Ambassador Baptist Church in Longmont and our new sister. Sister Christian Reformed Church, Jesus on Colfax Ministries, Centennial, Colorado. And then as a reminder and kind of the end thing, you can find these announcements and many more in our weekly email announcements called the Journey Jottings. If you want to receive the Journey Jottings, our weekly prayer requests email and or would like to submit new and updated prayer requests, you can contact Glenda Faust at glenda@journeyoflongmont.org. I know she puts a lot into those. A lot of people do. There's a lot of different parts to it. So if you're at all interested and want to see what's going on, you can contact Glenda for that. I'm pretty sure that there was something else, but no one's saying anything, so I'm going to give it to Rick because he's going to do a thing.
Gracias, Gail. Thank you very much. Well, good morning, everybody. Good to be with you this morning. And we have a special and sad thing for us, but exciting for the Williams. Brian and Alicia Williams have been a part of the journey before they were Brian and Alicia Williams. Well, they were always Brian and Alicia, but not Williams together. So, but they were here and then got married here, which was really cool. God, how long have you guys, Brian, how long have you been here? Like 2013, I was going to say. It's like 8, 9 years. So, and Alicia, when did you move from? 2015. So we've just been blessed to have you guys be a part of this community. And this week, Brian and Alicia and their incredibly cute kids are going to be moving to Kentucky. They bought a home in Kentucky and God opened up a great opportunity for them to be able to go there. And so what we wanted to be able to do, what we just love being able, I mean, we hate seeing you leave, but one of the things we love doing is being able to bless people as they go. And in essence, bless you out of here. And so what we'd love to have you do is if you guys could come on up. And I know we're in we're in that weird COVID stage right now. And so are you guys okay with people coming up and gathering around you?
Yes.
You guys okay? So for anybody else that would like to come up and gather around them, and if not, otherwise just lay your, we're going to just lift our hands out and bless. But I'm just grateful for the time that you've been with us, for the gifts that you've offered, for the fact that you've always had hearts that have wanted to serve and have always appreciated that. And so with that, just grateful for the friendship, grateful for the fact that we're brothers and sisters. And I think this has been a great example, Brian, of the fact that as siblings, we may not always get along, but we always love each other. And there's just beauty, and there's, Brian and I have had many conversations over the years. And but it's just this, but there's a beauty in this that it's like, no, that's the redemptive work of Christ, right? We don't have to be in alignment, per se, of, come on, what's a uniformity? That's what I was looking for, right? It's not uniformity. It's alignment with Christ, and to have the Holy Spirit it be the one that gathers us in and folds us together into his family and into his body. And the gifts that you guys have offered, the gifts that he's given you and that have offered the church, we've been grateful for. And so with that, guys, let's just stand up and then lay our hands forward and pray a blessing over these guys. God, we are so grateful to have watched what you have done in Brian's life, how you've moved him from one that was outside the family to one who is inside the family. For Alicia, for one who grew up in the family, and then to be able to see her own this family as her own, and then to have them come together as husband and wife to raise two beautiful children and one on the way to follow you, to be woven into the fabric of your body, your family. God, we've been blessed to have them here. And we're grateful for all that you've done in this community because you've had them here. And Lord, we pray that as they move on from this place, that we trust your Spirit will go with them, that you guide them to another community, another family where their gifts can be used and to build up your body and to bless others. We pray for safe travel from here to Kentucky. We pray that this home this house might become a home, and that you will continue to work in them, to draw them close to you, and to work through them in your world. So God, we pray this blessing over them. Lord, may you bless them and keep them. May you shine your face upon them. May you turn your face toward them. And in this travel and in their next endeavors, may you give them peace, everlasting peace. We pray this all in your name. And all God's people said, amen. 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 Love you guys. So after the service, obviously, we've got the picnic. So if they are around, make sure you get a chance to say your goodbye and give them your blessing as well. Hey, this week, we're grateful to be able to have Derek Brower preach for us again today. I am actually going to give this introduction. So today, this morning, when I opened up my email quick just to make sure there was nothing I missed, I saw Derek's PowerPoint and the passage that he was going to preach on. And I'm excited about this because this is one of those foundational gospel passages for me to be able to see Jesus engage kind of every aspect of our lives, the lives that we have as people who need Jesus, at least the life that I have as one who gets too often sucked into the religiosity of this church life, and yet to be drawn back to what is grace. And so with that, I'm just going to welcome Derek. Thanks again, bro, for bringing the word, and we anticipate God speaking through you.
No pressure. None whatsoever.
Now, I was so happy that we were going to talk about, have that break in between the announcements that I really didn't want to follow, because who can follow that? That was awesome. That's like the best announcement, you can do. And I'm like, okay, good. Now Rick's going to talk for a little while. We're going to have this bittersweet time. And then I can come up and preach, and there will be no pressure whatsoever to follow a great act. No offense, Rick. But, it was just... And then, Rick says that, by the way, this is like a core message in the journey. And Derek, don't mess up. No pressure. So we'll just start with, this is the goal of this message. And I need to bring this up because maybe you wonder what this is about. What's going on here when this person stands up here and does this thing that we're doing right now? What's the purpose of this? Okay, well, as it turns out, it's not just teaching. I'm not just trying to throw out some factoids to all y'all. That's not the thing I'm trying to do. I'm also not going to try to tell you how to live your life, though I am going to say right now, right up front, don't drink coffee at night. And that'll come up later on, okay? And not just because I drink a lot of coffee at night, because I really don't, and you'll find out why. But if I'm going to say anything about how to lead your life, no Red Bull, no coffee at night. But that's not the purpose either. The purpose of this is that we experience the gospel. You don't hear the gospel. I actually want you to experience it. When I go to a good church service and I hear a good sermon, what I expect is I want to know the gospel message again. I want to feel Jesus' forgiveness of me. I want to know that I'm right with God. I want to know these things. I want to feel them. I want to live the gospel message again. That's the goal of this message. No pressure. Let's pray. Lord God, I ask you to help us all to feel that this morning, to help us to be at your feet and listening to you and feeling your forgiveness. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, to talk about this passage, we have to do a little bit of background, okay? And the background's going to be pretty scary. In fact, this whole message, frankly, is going to be a little bit scary. It might make you a little uncomfortable. So let's just dive into that part of it. Yay, with a verse from Leviticus, because that's always the happiest part. Leviticus 20:10, this is part of, I've sometimes called it the Dr. Seuss passages in the Bible, because it's a lot of, if you've green eggs and ham, not with a, you know, not on a house, not with a mouse, all those sort of things. Well, this is all those sort of things. Don't do this, don't do that, don't do this. And this is one of them. If a man commits adultery with his neighbor's wife, both the adulterer and the adulteress must be put to death. What a happy passage. But this is one of those double tap ones, and you always got to watch out for the double taps in the Bible, where the same thing is said again two books later, two chapters later, in Deuteronomy 22:22. If a man is found sleeping with another man's wife, both the man who slept with her and the woman must die. You must purge the evil from Israel. Okay. So from there, I'm going to read a passage from the book of John. This is John 8, starts about verse 2. And this is Jesus. Well, let's read it. Early in the morning, Jesus came again to the temple. All the people came to him, and he sat down and began to teach them. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery, and making her stand before all of them, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the very act of committing adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such a woman. Now what do you say?" They said this to test him, so that they might have some charge to bring against him. Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, "Let anyone among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." And once again, he bent down and wrote on the ground. When they heard it, they went away, one by one, beginning with the elders, the oldest. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. Jesus straightened up and asked her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, sir." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go your way, and from now on, do not sin again." First, let's look at the tricky bits. If you have one of these study Bibles, like this one, this is my NIV study Bible. It is a, it's got a gross vehicle weight. I'm going to just demonstrate that real quick here for you. Yeah. Beware of anybody that shows up at a church with one of these things. They are quite heavy. If you look up this passage in the study Bible, what you'll notice is it's decorated like a Christmas tree. There are little footnotey things all over the place. Some study Bibles put the whole passage in italics. There's always a note up at the top that says some really scary things. So let's just kind of look at that real quick. And the reason I bring this up is because you might get tripped up by that. You might be reading this passage in the Bible, you get to all that italics and all that nasty stuff and go, "Oh, I don't need to worry about this passage." Oh, no, I think you do. So the first thing it always says there is it says the best manuscripts. It's missing. It's missing from the best manuscripts or the oldest manuscripts. The book of John is actually really well documented back to about the first century, or about 120 AD is when we've got some really awesome clips of it. And we don't have the whole thing until a couple centuries later, but we know from those earliest fragments that we've got of the book of John that we've got a really clean copy of this thing. And we know John wrote it, too. We're pretty sure of that because John's writing style is very, very distinct. We'll get into that for a second. So it says it's missing from the best manuscripts, and that's scary. Okay, all right, I get that. Also, it's kind of jarringly out of place. Have you ever watched a movie where they're at night and they're talking and then suddenly it's daytime and they're still having the same conversation? The problem with those bad editing, what do they call it? Continuity. The bad continuity is that it takes you out of the story. And this one does too, because immediately in the a chapter prior to this, it's in the Sanhedrin and Nicodemus is there. He comes up earlier in the book. And he has this interchange with Jesus that goes kind of poorly for him, but he seems changed. And so when he's in the Sanhedrin, and he's talking to all the leaders of Israel and the religious life there, he takes Jesus' defense. Fun fact, Nicodemus looks really good in this passage. Another fun fact, Jesus isn't there, nor is John or any of the disciples. So how does it end up in the Bible? How does John know to write about this? I think Nicodemus tells John what happened, and that's why Nicodemus looks so great in that passage. Anyway, just my theory. But it goes from there directly to this passage, and there's not a really great continuity that happens. It ends with, and they all went back to their own homes, but Jesus went to the Mount of Olives, which is not where he is, by the way. He's in the temple. So there's definitely a continuity problem. It looks like they just dropped this manuscript, this little story right in there. Also, the Greek doesn't match. I am pretty good at the Greek. I learned it in seminary, and I was one of those people that went, this is fun. And that puts me in a really small minority of people who go to seminary. But I really enjoyed the Greek. But the Greek doesn't match. John's Greek is very distinctive. He does a lot with very little. He has very small vocabulary. He doesn't do anything tricky with the verbs or anything like that. And so you can read straight through John, and his letters read just like it. Even Revelation looks a lot like, even though there's a lot more going on there with bigger, more vocabulary. So, but when you get to this passage, it changes. And you know what it looks like? It looks like Luke. It looks like Luke's writing. And the style doesn't fit. Because if you've read the book of John, you know that Jesus is a little wordy. Can we say that? I think we can say that. But every passage in John where Jesus does something, it always ends up with a little bit of an exposition afterwards. Either Jesus tells you what he just did, or John goes, well, this is what he just did. But either way, they kind of describe what happens at the end of in each passage. Unless this one, because this story just sort of ends. And so there's a little bit of a style change to it, too. And what does this mean? Well, it means that, yeah, this passage doesn't really belong here. But it does belong. It has authenticity because it looks a lot like Luke's writing. And here's at least one theory that I have about this. I think that Luke had an editor. And the editor read this story and went, are you sure you want to say that? This doesn't really fit your book. Are you feeling real good about this? I do a fair amount of this public speaking thing at work, and I've done this a lot, and I've always got an editor who says, are you sure you want to say that? And sometimes they're right, like probably all of you thinking right now, maybe Jarek should leave this part out. But sometimes they're wrong, and it's really important that I leave it in there. Okay, so I think that Luke had some people around him that after Luke was probably long gone, they were reading through the passage and went, you know, this just doesn't fit here. Let's take this out. But there was a group that went, no, we really like that passage. Let's hold on to it. And eventually they ran into some of John's people who were sort of holding on to his stuff and went, the guys at Luke won't put this in. You got a place for this? And the John people went, and they just put it in. I'd like to say it was more artful than that, and I think it probably was. They probably tried, but, you know, they also didn't change the language. They didn't make it sound like John. They just went, we're going to go for it. We're going to put it in here, and that's why I think it's authentic, because if it wasn't authentic, I think they would have made it work, and they didn't. They just went, no, it's not so great. We're just going to toss it in there. So that's that part of it. I just want to throw that out there because I don't want anyone to look at this passage and go, well, it's, you know, got issues, so we don't have to pay attention to it. I think you have to pay attention to it, and I think it's very authentic. It's a cool story, and actually, just about every commentary, every scholar I read said, no, this is a very authentic passage. Just because it's in the wrong place doesn't make it bad. I wanted to throw that out there. I thought that was important. Just me? Yeah, happens. Okay, well, let's look at the passage. What happens there? What's really going on? Well, first, I have some questions. Maybe you do, too. Where's her dance partner? This isn't breakdancing that we're talking about. This is more of a tango. You remember those passages from Leviticus and Deuteronomy? It says both of them are supposed to be put to death. So where's he? Stone her? Really? Is that what they're off to here? Is that what they're going to do? Now, it sure looks like it. Apparently, they're holding or juggling rocks. They've got stones in their hands, so it looks like this is what they're going for. But is that what they're really up to? Because it seems a little strange that it doesn't fit exactly the law of Moses, but now they're at this place where they look like they're really going to do it. Is that what they're really up to? Interestingly, the rabbis of the time had said that the person who should throw the first stone should be the person who was witness. In the passage, she was caught in the very act of adultery. I mean, somebody saw it going on. Who's that person? Where is that person? And where's her dance partner? There's a lot of questions going on with this. And who is that first witness? Also, why are there so many witnesses? What is Jesus writing? And to be honest, nobody really knows the answer to this question. Some people think that Jesus is writing the sins of the people, of the Pharisees and the scribes. That's a pretty good explanation. I like that one. But we don't really know. What I do think Jesus is doing is giving a nice pause, letting them really dig a big hole, right? Let's just not rush the story along. Let's pause and let it kind of play out just a little bit. And I think that's what Jesus is doing because he really wants them to make a big mess. And why did the men really walk away? Well, look, the whole thing is a trap. She's the bait. They're trying to trap Jesus, and they're trying to get him in this trap. And so the whole thing is contrived. And I think we're pretty sure of that because the guy's not there. Her partner in crime is not involved. There's something already wrong with the whole situation. She's grabbed, she's dragged through town, she's brought to the temple and brought before Jesus, and it's a trap. So he's got a couple options here. He can say, no, 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 we shouldn't stone her, but if you don't stone her, that goes against the law of Moses. Okay, that can't happen. Jesus can't allow that to occur because if he goes against the law of Moses, he becomes a blasphemer. He loses his credibility as a teacher in Israel, and that's not going to get him going forward. Again, these are people who just want Jesus out of the picture. They don't really care how Jesus gets out of the picture. They don't need that. They don't need to be the cause. They just need it done. They need Jesus discredited. They need him gone. They need all the people to see it, and that's their goal here. That's the trap they're trying to get her in. Okay, so he could say, let's stone her. Let's light this candle. Let's do this thing. Well, that makes a big problem for him because, one, he's got no compassion at that point, and he becomes out a hypocrite. He loses his credibility with the people that he's indeed talking to, the people who came to see him at the temple. Also, it's against the law of the Romans. The Romans had this, well, they were the law and order candidate. That's not really the right way to put it. Nobody voted him in. They were definitely very much about law and order, okay? And it was their law that was the important thing. Now, when Jesus was crucified, he was crucified by the Romans because the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Sanhedrin, the Jewish leaders didn't have the authority to do so. They had to go to Rome. They had to go to Pontius Pilate and go, well, we need you to do this thing because we don't have the authority to do it. Which means it's a very interesting situation up here in the temple on this day because if they do start throwing stones, they're all guilty of doing something Rome has said is against the law. Rome liked to be the ones who did the executions, and did they ever love to do executions? So they didn't want to share that fun with anybody else, apparently. So Jesus can't break the law of the Romans without getting everybody in trouble. And what they're looking for here is they're looking for them to be able to throw some stones, and when the Romans show up and go, what are you doing? They go, well, he told us to. Either way, their problem is solved. Now Jesus gets taken away by the Romans, and he's out of their hair. He's not a problem for them anymore. And that's their goal. That's the trap that they're trying to spring. Well, Jesus doesn't fall into the trap. And when Jesus doesn't fall into the trap, they've got a real problem. See, you don't have to be a sinless person to actually execute her, but by abdicating to a sinless person, Jesus affirms both of the laws and retains his compassion. He kind of outsmarts them, to be honest. So we've got three characters in this story: Jesus, the Pharisees, scribes, the leaders, and the woman. And at this point, Jesus is being lured into a trap by the bait, and she's the bait. And Jesus outsmarts him. He says, okay, fine, we could stone her. He affirms the law. But the one without sin is going to be the one that's going to lead you down this path. And when he does that, he short circuits the whole thing, and he walks out of the trap. He retains his position. He affirms both laws, and he really gets them. And at this point, the older people go, yeah, we're not going to get this done here today. And they just kind of walk away. And the young people, you know that they're looking for a fight, right? You got to have them. If you're going to have a mob, you have to have a mob. So there's always some people leading the mob, and then there's a lot of people hanging out going, I hope this goes really bad. And those guys, they kind of realize that they're in trouble, and they leave later. And that leaves two characters left, Jesus and the woman. So let's talk about her for a second. She's bait. She's bait in a trap. Well, the bait never comes out of the trap really great. And she's not going to come out of this good at all. Up until about a couple seconds ago, you know, as the story is unfolding, it looked like this was the worst day of her life and, conveniently, the last day of her life. Wouldn't want to go past this one for too much longer because it's clearly she's in a lot of trouble at this point. She's been dragged out of her home. Her husband has probably seen this happen. He's not going to be too happy about it. She's been dragged away from her family. A bunch of people are watching this go down, and she is guilty by association no matter what. She's standing there, and this is the worst feeling. They've told her she's guilty, and maybe she is. But more devastating, I would suggest, is that she feels guilty. Whether it's her fault or not her fault, whether she's the victim or the perpetrator, it doesn't matter at this point. She is wrapped up in this, and she will wear this the rest of her life because she is this thing now. I associate this with what I call the 4 a.m. feeling. Because when I look at the story, let me back up just a second. When I look at the story, I say, who are we in this story? Are we the Pharisees and Sadducees trying to, you know, uphold this really draconian law? Are we bringing this woman to Jesus? Honestly, if you ever find yourself kind of identifying with that group, check yourself. That's not the right group. They don't win, okay? Are we Jesus in this case? Well, okay, you can forgive sins. You can forgive people who do that to you. But, you know, Jesus is Jesus, and we're not. If we could be Jesus, we wouldn't need Jesus. We need Jesus, so we're not. So what would Jesus do? Jesus would do Jesus things. What are we going to do? Not Jesus things, because we don't have that power, okay? So we're not the Jesus character. What character are we? We're the woman. We're the woman standing there being accused. I call it the 4 a.m. feeling. At 4 o'clock in the morning, the world is asleep. The people who have been partying all night, they even go to sleep. I'm a triathlete. I don't get up at 4 o'clock in the morning. And we're usually the only people up that early, okay? You see us all over the roads if you go to work very early, riding our bikes and doing our thing. And we don't even get up that early. 4 o'clock in the morning, the animals even go, you know, it's late. We should go to bed. At 4 o'clock in the morning, if you're awake, your mind decides to play a little game with you. My mind likes to bring up every single thing I've ever done wrong in my entire life. It likes to talk to me and say, remember that time two nights ago when you were at the party and you said that really stupid joke? Everybody thought you were an idiot. Remember that time, this really did happen, when you were kind of nosing your car out into the intersection and that truck almost blared right through you, almost killed you? Remember that? Remember how dumb you were that time? Remember that awful thing you did to that person when you said that thing you didn't mean to say and it was uncaring and it wasn't nice? That was a bad thing to do. In fact, there's so many of these bad things that you've done, these wrong things that you've done. You're not just doing bad things. I think you're actually bad. You're officially a bad person. It goes on and on. In my head, I look at how I eat or how much I work out. Who knew? I mean, I kind of fanatically work out. You know what part of drives me on that one? Is because that I need to be that person. I've got to be that person because if I'm not that person, I'm a weak person. I'm weak in character. And people will see that. And if they see that in me, they'll know that I am not a great guy. And I go through all the things in my life. I go all the bad dietary decisions I made that make this happen. And there is something here, trust me. These are not pecs, okay? I didn't want to grab those because that seemed weird on the video. But the but I deal with all this shame. The shame is not, see, guilt is when you do a bad thing. Shame is when you internalize that and believe that to be you. And that's what they're saying to her. She didn't commit adultery. They said she's an adulteress. It becomes a title. It becomes a badge. It becomes who we become. I think that's what she's feeling right there. She's not just feeling guilt. I think this is more than that. Now she's feeling shame. I'm pretty sure this is a very common thing because if you're familiar with Brené Brown, she's the great shame researcher, and she's wildly popular. Now, why would somebody who researches shame be wildly popular if shame was not wildly common? It shouldn't be popular. And I think that's how we feel. That's how I feel. At 4 o'clock in the morning, I just want my brain to shut up. I want to go back to sleep. I want the voice to be silent. And sometimes my brain gets really dark, and I start to come up with ways to make the voice shut up, because I need it to shut up. I need to not be this person, this bad person. That's me at 4 o'clock in the morning. Maybe it's you at 4 o'clock in the morning too. That's why you don't drink coffee at night. See, I can drink coffee at night, and I'll fall right asleep. And then 2 hours later, I'll be awake, and this is the game I play all night. That's what the woman's feeling right then. That's what she's feeling. She's standing there in front of Jesus, probably in disarray. They've trapped her. She might even be a victim. We're not saying that the guy she was with had a nice car, maybe some ripped abs. He was a yoga teacher. He was a great listener. And her husband was like some creepy dude who wasn't very nice. We're not saying that at all. I'm not saying that was who she was with at all. I think they trapped her. I think they made her into an adulteress. And I think that she is a victim here, and they're blaming the victim. I think it could be the worst possible way of looking at this. And she may be guilty of sin, but she's mostly just guilty of the tragedy that's happening. And at that point, Jesus is sitting there, and he has to say something to her. And he says, where are those that condemn you, who accuse you? She says, they're gone. They've all left. And Jesus said, I do not condemn you either. Go, and from now on, no more sin. And I've read this a couple different ways. I'm going to tell you the way I think it's supposed to be read. Because that last line doesn't seem real helpful to me at 4 o'clock in the morning. I've tried not to sin my entire life. I'm in like in my mid-50s-ish. And I have been, when I go through my litany of bad things that I've done, they go all the way back 50 years. And boy, I've tried over and over again to not do any more of them. And they keep happening. They keep happening. And I wish they wouldn't, because I want that voice to be quiet. No more sin. That's what I want. And that's what Jesus says to her. Go, and from now on, no more sin. I'm looking at it as a promise now. This is the promise of Jesus. The promise of Jesus is that we're forgiven, that his blood covered our sin, that his blood on the cross, his forgiveness is good enough, not only to cover up the bad things we do, but to cover up even that we are bad. Because we're not. In Christ, we are good again. That's what I want you to feel today. I want you to know it. But not just know it, but feel it. At 4 o'clock in the morning, someone can flick on the light and look at you and say, you're not bad. You're good. You're forgiven. Because of Jesus, we have been forgiven. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you that you sent Jesus to make up the distance between us and you. We thank you so much that we have a path back. We thank you that we are good because of what Jesus did for us on the cross. We thank you that he paid the price for our sin, not just to get rid of our guilt, but to get rid of our shame, to cover it, to expunge it, to remove it from us. We thank you, Lord, that this is your gospel. We thank you, Lord, that we can live and know that the sins we committed and the sins we will commit are covered by your love and your forgiveness.
Thank you.
your promises, and we believe your promises that you don't remember our sins, and you throw them as far as the east is from the west. And thank you for your mercy being more and for your amazing grace. And we just praise you for that today. In your name we pray, amen. Please stand as we continue to worship.
Forever.
Lord, thank you for this time this morning. Thank you so much for this wonderful music. Thank you, Lord. Would you all humor me for a moment? Put your hands out like you're accepting a gift. And by the way, I normally listen to the music and go, you know, this would be better with bass. Not today. Go today, be at peace. Know the love, the mercy, and the grace of Jesus. Amen. Oh, and there's a picnic. Go to the pickup.